गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, द पार्ट 5 ऑफ द लेसन इक्विलिब्रियम इज द चेंज इन प्रेशर एंड दिस हेडिंग इज अंडर द कैटेगरी ली चैटेलियर्स प्रिंसिपल. सो द चेंज ऑफ द प्रेशर ऑल्सो हैज ऑल्सो एन इम्पॉर्टेंट इफेक्ट ऑन द इक्विलिब्रियम ऑफ अ रिएक्शन विच इन्वॉल्व गैसियस सब्सटेंस एंड देयर इज नो There is change in total number of moles of gases in reactant and the product. So, according to the Lee-Chatelier's principle, increase of pressure, if the pressure is increased, so the increase of pressure on a system at equilibrium will shift the equilibrium in the direction in which pressure is reduced. Will shift the equilibrium will be shifted to that direction where the pressure will be reduced. So as the pressure of the gaseous system is increased, the volume occupied by the system decreases, so that the total number of moles per unit volume increases. So to undo this stress, the reaction which produces a small number of moles, the reaction, this is a very important term, very important point, the reaction which produces a small number of moles of gaseous substance will be favored, so that the increased pressure is reduced. This can be explained by following example. Let us consider the example that is N2 plus 3H2 gives 2NH3. Let us discuss the formation of the ammonia. So, on increasing the pressure, as the pressure increases, the volume occupied by the system will be decreases. When we apply the pressure on this reaction or this system, the volume occupied by these gases will be decreases. As a result, there will be large number of moles of gases per unit volume. So the effect of increased pressure can be undone if equilibrium shift in the direction which produces lesser number of gaseous mole. Now look at this reaction. The number of mole in the products are 2. We have the 2 mole of NH3, and let us count the number of moles in the reactant, that is 3 plus 1, this one is the 4. So here we have the 2 number of moles and here we have the 4 number of moles, that is 2, and 3 plus 1 is equal to 4. So the equilibrium will shift in the direction of where we have the lesser number of moles. So in this case, the lesser number of moles is in the forward direction. This is the forward direction. So the equilibrium will shift towards the ammonia or the forward reaction, and more ammonia is formed. As a result of it, more ammonia is formed. So just revise the topic. This is 3 plus 1, that is the 4 number of moles, here only 2 number of moles. So when we apply the more pressure or when we increase the pressure, the equilibrium will shift in that direction where the lesser number of moles are present. So we know that in the forward direction, the reaction is N2 plus 3H2 gives 2NH3. And in the backward direction, 2NH3 is split into 3H2 and N2. So the lesser number of moles are here, that is with the ammonia. So it shifted towards the forward reaction and more ammonia will be formed. So this is the effect of change of pressure on the equilibrium. And if there is no change in the number of moles of the gaseous reactant and the product, the pressure will have no effect on the equilibrium. For example, we have H2 plus I2 gives 2HI. Now look at this reaction. Here in the product 2, number of moles are 2, and here in the reactant the number of moles are 2, that is 1 plus 1, that is 2. So in that case, if the number of moles on the reactant as well as on the product are same, so there will be no effect of the pressure on the equilibrium. Now here the pressure will have no effect on equilibrium. That is the effect of the pressure. So for that, increase in pressure shift the equilibrium. Increase in pressure, if we increase the pressure, the equilibrium will be shifted to the lesser number of gaseous moles. And if decrease in pressure, then equilibrium will be shift the equilibrium to the larger or more, that is larger number of gaseous moles. So next is the effect of the catalyst. So the catalyst has no effect on the equilibrium, and this is because catalyst favors the rate of the forward and the backward reaction equally. That's why it has the no effect on the equilibrium. It simply helps to achieve the equilibrium quickly, and it may also be noted that the catalyst has no effect on the equilibrium composition of a reaction mixture. So the catalyst do not shift the equilibrium in any of the direction, not in the forward direction as well as not in the backward direction. Now the next is the effect of volume. Effect of volume. We have discussed this topic in this, under this heading. So we know that the increase in the pressure, when we increase the pressure, the volume is decreased. So the increase in the pressure means decrease in the volume. So the effect of change of volume will be exactly reverse, will be exactly opposite to that of the pressure. Thus, decreasing the volume of a reaction mixture at equilibrium, so the equilibrium shift in the direction of the lesser number when we decrease the volume. So the equilibrium will be shift to the lesser number of the molecule, and when we increase the volume, the equilibrium will be shift to the larger number of the gaseous mole. So the effect of the volume is opposite to that of the pressure. So we can write it here as a, for example, increase, that is increase in volume, shift the equilibrium to the larger number of moles, and when we decrease, that is when we decrease in volume, so it will be shifted to the lesser number of gaseous mole, lesser number of gaseous mole. So look at here, it is exactly opposite of this one. The effect of the volume is exactly opposite to that of the effect of the pressure. Here when we increase the pressure, it will shift it to the lesser number of the gaseous mole. Here when we increase the volume, it will shift it to the larger number of the gaseous mole. Now look at the look at here, that decrease in the pressure, it will shift to the larger number of the gaseous mole, and when we decrease the volume, it will shift it to the lesser number of the gaseous mole. So these two are the opposite to each other, that is the pressure and the volume. Now the last one is the effect of inert gases, effect of inert gases on the equilibrium. So when an inert gas is added to the equilibrium system at constant volume, when the volume is constant, then the total pressure will be increases, the total pressure will be increases. But the concentration of the reactant and the product, the concentration of the reactant and the product, it means that the ratio of their moles to the volume of the container will not change. The ratio is not changed, only the pressure is increased. Hence, these conditions, under these conditions, there will be no effect on the equilibrium. There will be no effect on the equilibrium when we add the inert gas at the constant volume. And what are the inert gases? Inert gases are the helium, neon, xenon, argon, krypton, radon. These all are the inert gases. So there will be no change in the concentration. There will be no change in the ratio. Only the pressure will be increased at the constant volume. Now, if the second is, if we added the inert gases at the constant pressure, we add the inert gases at the constant pressure. So when an inert gas is added to the equilibrium system at constant pressure, then the volume will increase. Then the volume will increase. As a result, the number of moles per unit volume of various reactant and product will decreases. Hence, the equilibrium will shift in the direction in which there is increase in the number of moles of the gases. Number of moles of the gases. So, these are the effect of the inert gases on the equilibrium. Now, the next heading is the ionic equilibrium. We all know very well that chemical reaction in solution, chemical reactions which takes place in solution plays very important role in chemistry. For example, when let us talk about the sodium chloride, that is the NaCl. We all know very well that NaCl or the sodium chloride does not conduct electricity in the solid state. This is the first topic. And the second is, when we dissolve the sodium chloride in water, it easily conducts the electricity, or it becomes the good conductor of electricity. So Michael Faraday classified the substance. Michael Faraday classified the substance into two categories. The one is electrolyte and the another one is the non-electrolyte. So the substance which conduct electricity in their molten state. Molten state means aqueous state. The substance which conduct electricity in their molten state or in the form of their aqueous solution are called electrolytes. Lights, for example, acids, bases and salts, they all are electrolytes. Acid, bases and salt are the example of the electrolyte. Now the next is the non-electrolyte. Now the non-electrolyte is the opposite of the electrolyte. It means that the substance which do not conduct electricity in the molten state or in the aqueous state are called the non-electrolyte. For example, the solution of a sugar, urea, glucose, they all are the non-electrolytes. So when an electrolyte, now the definition of electrolyte is I think clear to all of you, that when an electrolyte is dissolved in water, when we dissolve the electrolyte in water, so it splits into ions. It splits into ions. For example, sodium chloride. So when the sodium chloride is dissolved in water, so it split into ion, that is Na plus NCl negative. These are the ion, this is the cation and this one is the anion. So sodium chloride in the solid state exists as a collection of the positive charged sodium and the negatively charged chloride ion. So these are held together by a strong electrostatic force. There is a strong electrostatic force of attraction in between the Na and the Cl. So the ions do not move because the force between these two is very strong. Therefore, the ion does not move freely. And when there is no ion, so we all know very well that is due to the lacking or the deficiency of ion, it is not possible for any solution to conduct the electricity. But when we dissolve this NaCl in water, so the force of attraction between this Na and the Cl, it broken down, and as it broken down, so it split into Na positive and Cl negative, means we get the ions. And we all know very well, when there is an ion, definitely there will be the conduction of the electricity. That's why, this is the reason, because in the solid state the force of attraction in between the Na and the Cl is very strong, but when we dissolve it in the liquid, so there will be the formation of the ions, and ions conduct electricity. So now the next term is the electrolytes. This electrolyte, so depending upon the extent of ionization, the electrolyte is divided into two categories. The one first is the strong electrolyte and the second one is the weak electrolyte. So let us talk about this strong electrolyte. The substance which ionizes completely, the substance which ionizes completely into ions in aqueous solution are called strong electrolytes. The example for the strong electrolyte is HCl. HCl is a strong electrolyte. NaOH. NaOH completely, it ionizes completely. That's why it is also a strong electrolyte. H2SO4, HNO3, NaCl, KOH. These all are the example of the strong electrolyte, because they ionizes completely in their aqueous solution. Now the equation for the ionization reaction, I am writing here the equation for the ionization reaction of the strong electrolyte. For example, we have HCl and we dissolve it in water, so it splits into H3O plus plus Cl negative. This H3O plus is known as the hydronium ion. This is known as the hydronium ion. And here I am using a double headed arrow. Before it we are using the sign of the equilibrium, but here I am using the double headed arrow. So this double headed arrow represent the complete ionization. It represent the complete ionization. So this is the example of the strong electrolyte which completely ionizes in the aqueous solution. Now the second one is the weak electrolyte. So weak electrolyte means the substances which ionizes to a small extent, in aqueous solution are called weak electrolyte. For example, ammonium hydroxide. For example, acetic acid, that is the formula for the acetic acid is CH3COOH. Ammonium hydroxide, NH4OH. hydrogen cyanide HCN, these all are the example of the weak electrolyte because they are ionizes in the aqueous solution to a small extent. And for that, for the ionization of the weak electrolyte, for example, we have CH3COOH. This is the acetic acid. This is a type of a weak acid. When it combined with the water, so here I am using a double headed arrow. Here I am using a, this is the equilibrium sign. This is the equilibrium sign. So it means that the ionization is not completed. It indicates the incomplete ionization. So we have CH3COO minus plus hydronium ion, that is H3O plus. So this is the weak acid. This is the example for the weak acid. And this is the example for the ionization of the strong acid. So the strong electrolytes, strong acids or the strong electrolytes are almost completely ionized in the aqueous solution. The unionized molecule are present to such a small extent that it is not any significance to study the ionization constant of the strong electrolyte. But in the weak electrolyte, there are only partial ionized and a dynamic equilibrium. This is the dynamic equilibrium is established after some time between the ions and unionized molecule. And this equilibrium is known as the ionic equilibrium. So the ionic equilibrium is defined as the equilibrium which is established, the equilibrium which is established between the unionized molecules and the ions in solution of weak electrolyte. The ionic equilibrium is only exist in between in the weak electrolyte is known as the ionic equilibrium. Now there are two terms. When you